these days, that peace, wonderful peace of Jesus Christ is so needed for the whole world itself, but so much more for the Christian who knows the truth and sees what's going on around us. It can seem like we've had that peace ripped away from us. And that's why it's so important to be in Christ, in His peace. That way, even amongst the trials, tribulations, struggles, the waves, the billows that are rolling, we can still have that comfortable, glorious, wonderful peace of Christ dwelling within our hearts. Mark chapter 2 and verse 16, the Bible says, "And when the scribes and the Pharisees saw him eat with publicans and sinners, they said unto his disciples, How is it that he eateth and drinketh with publicans and sinners? When Jesus heard it, he saith unto them, They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." What I'm talking about today and focusing in on is that phrase, "They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick." I'm talking today about unclean vaccines. Unclean vaccines. Jesus here is very clear in his presentation of, yes, a salvation message, and why he would come to the sinners and to the publicans and to those for their need of salvation, because those were humble and they were admittedly sinners. They were publicans. They knew what they did in their spare time, and therefore, just as we go door to door and we reach the poor quite often very easily with the gospel, it's because they are ready to admit that they are a sinner. That's the first step to the plan of salvation. He's using the idea of a physician, essentially saying, "Hey, I'm the great physician, and those that have no need of the physician, what good is the point of me being here? It's but they that are sick that have need of the physician." We're talking again about unclean vaccines. Now, first thing I want to point out is that I am not the great physician. I am no physician of any way, shape, or form. That's not my place, that's not my job, that's not my calling. But what I do want to look at is the idea of uncleanness and how vaccines relate to it from a biblical standpoint. Again, I'm not a doctor. I'm not going to give you medical advice. If you go and make a decision from this day on, I don't want it to have anything to do with what I'm saying here. I want it to be first and foremost what the Bible says, and we should use that for all matters of faith and practice. Jesus, again, he says, "Those that are whole have no need of the physician." And yet today, we have what we call preemptive medications for diseases that don't even aren't even affecting us. We don't even have them. They may not have even touched our neighborhood, our locality, or anything. Literally, there is no foreseeable risk of us having said sickness, and yet preemptively we medicate. Preemptively we administer a remedy for a sickness that we don't even have. And Jesus says that's contrary to logical thinking, especially biblical thinking, that says, well, if you're whole, what need have you of the physician? No, it's them that are sick that have a need of physician. And that is something I do want to point out from this, is that Jesus doesn't say, hey, nobody has any need of a physician. He says that there's just a time and a place. And if you're not sick, if you are whole, then what need have you of the physician? Physicians are there to cure those that are ailing, to cure those that are sick. So backwards in the world that we have. Sick, what does that mean? That just means to be tired, to be ill, to be hurting, to have a disease, to have something within your body causing you great trials and struggles within. You're not feeling your greatest. What I'm sick of today is the idea of vaccinations and how they're being pushed and how the medical industry is working to enforce these types of things. Just as I was even talking with my wife and some of my friends in these past few days, I've been going through this barrage of emotions. I've been seeing these posts on Facebook where these godless atheists are holding up signs that basically just say, "Vaccinate your bleeping kids." Okay, they're holding up this sign on one half of the slide, and then the whole meme of it all, the whole idea they're trying to portray is these guys, these atheists, these godless souls are saying, "Vaccinate your bleeping kids." And over here, they're saying, "We did." And I'm looking at this string of hashtag, "We did, we did, we did." And every one of them is some child that was perfectly healthy, newborn, and then within days is dead. A perfectly healthy and cared for and flourishing young child, and then is suddenly sick. A perfectly well-being young child running about, doing their own business, they're sick, they're dead. One of those things, and I'm just seeing this string of this same thing. Hey, vaccinate your kids, the world says. And then these people, these hurting souls are saying, well, we did, and this is what happened. We did, and this is what happened. We did, and this is what happened. And so my stomach is in this wretch of a mess where I'm angry. I'm sad. There's a tear in my eye. I'm hurting. I'm emotional. I'm just all over the place because, hey, vaccinate your kids. And then we did, and look what happened. We did, and look what happened. All these injuries upon injuries upon injuries that are just pouring out from the world. And, you know, praise God for the social media that allows us to at least see those types of things, which normally would have been kind of swept under a rug and given a different title. But people are coming forward and saying, hey, I did what you said, physician. I was not sick. I was whole. I had no need of it. You told me to administer this. And we did. And now look. And now look. And now look. And the hurts that I'm seeing and the struggles and the people that are going through such pain and loss and mourning of following what a trusted doctor said and then having their child succumb to death, succumb to great injuries, succumb to sicknesses beyond what they could ever imagine, being hooked to tubes just to keep them alive. And I am sick of seeing this. Sick to my stomach. This is like the worst type of insurance scam. This is like them basically, because there is a fear that you might get such and such a disease, we are going to insure by administering this in order that you won't get that disease, which was never a real fear to begin with. It's like this sorry excuse for an insurance plan, except instead of us just giving money away and being ripped off in that fashion, we're giving up our health and being ripped off in that fashion. And we're doing it quite often to those that are most innocent and most vulnerable, and that's the young folks. Parents trusting their physician, and though their child shows no symptoms, though their child has no fear of ever succumbing to such and such a disease, they administer the remedy before. And that's the insurance plan that has such a high cost, and the reward is rare. I mean, yeah, if your kid doesn't sick, hey, the reality is they might not have never gotten sick anyways. Like I said, they're basically just rolling the dice and hoping for the best on a long shot that they might get such and such, and I'm so afraid for my child, I administer the remedy for a disease that wasn't present, and sickness as a result of it. So what do you think, turn to John chapter 11, what do you think Christians ought to do when it comes to sickness? I think there's a few. First of all, again, they that are sick have need of the physician. Jesus Christ was plain there. There is a time and a place for the physician's work, for his specialty. But what should we do in just the general case? Well, John chapter 11 gives us some principles for this. John chapter 11 and verse 3. Therefore his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. So here, worried sisters of a loved one whom Jesus loved, we know this as Lazarus, reached out to Christ. They called upon the Lord to come and to help their sick loved one. He had need of a physician because, yes, he indeed was sick. Look down at verse 7. It says, then after that saith he unto his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and thou goest thither again. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. So they're wondering, Jesus, why are you going there? This sickness is not unto death. Well, what need have you to go and to see Lazarus? Or what need have you to go and to risk your life and enter into a place where the Jews sought to stone thee? And he said, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then his disciples said, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. So the first principle that I can pull from this scripture about what to do when a Christian is sick, biblically speaking, is get rest. The disciples were really understanding that, well, if him that is sick and is not unto death is resting, if he is asleep, he shall do well. It's plain, it's common sense. They're saying, well, he's obviously getting healing and rest, and so this is a good thing, and we ought to do the same. When we are sick, we ought to rest. Verse 13, howbeit Jesus spake of his death, and it continues on, and we know the rest of the story. The principle there, though, is that when you're sick, hey, just get rest. I was sick not too long ago, Brother Yuri, you just came out of being sick. And I was talking to Miss Alex about it, and I said, you know what, sometimes I believe God just allows for me to get sick, because if I don't get sick, I just won't stop. I won't get rest. I won't take a break. I won't take a whole Saturday and just relax and recuperate and let my body, because there's always something else to do. There's not enough hours in the day, especially when you've got a full-time job, you've got a family that's growing, you've got responsibilities, you have a desire to get out and to reach the lost. There's so many things you can do on a Saturday, and yet God just, you know, put me out on my back sick. And I believe sometimes it's just God saying, hey, it's time for you to take a rest. It's time for you to take a break. And sometimes maybe that's the only way that I'll get it. But that's my principle. That's the first principle I see in the Bible. When you're sick, the Bible solution is to get rest. Go back to Leviticus chapter 13. Leviticus chapter 13, if you would. Way back at the beginning of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus chapter 13. The first principle of what we ought to do when we're sick is get rest. Look at Leviticus chapter 13 and verse 44. It says, he is a leprous man. Again, he's sick. He is unclean. The priest shall pronounce him utterly unclean. This plague is in his head. And the leper in whom the plague is, his clothes shall be rent, and his head bare. He shall put a covering upon his upper lip and shall cry, unclean, unclean. All the days wherein the plague shall be in him, he shall be defiled. He is unclean. He shall dwell alone. Without the camp shall his habitation be. The second principle that I see in the scriptures for what to do when we're sick, dwell alone. Be separate, be apart, even to the point of going unclean, unclean, giving yourself space from those that aren't sick, in order that you wouldn't pass it on. It's a great principle, and it seems that the Bible was ahead of its time because germ theory came so much later in history. But Jesus himself, revealing through the book of Leviticus by the pen of Moses, reveals that dwelling alone is a good thing to do for someone that is sick. They are segregated. They are separate. They're not going to get everyone else around them sick. I believe that also gives them opportunity for new principle number one, and that's just to get rest. Because they're alone. They're not distracted. But they're doing something out of kindness and out of goodness and out of righteousness when they say, I'm unclean, and they give some space, and they stay away, and they stay home. And I encourage that even. I know that because I'm the preacher, I have to come in here sometimes when I'm not feeling so good. But I encourage others, hey, if you're sick, don't drag yourself in here to just get everyone else sick, to not get any rest yourself. I'm a strong encourager, and I believe that the best thing that you can do when you're sick is to get rest and just stay separate. Too many of these diseases and these flus, we saw it really kicked off around Christmas time. Well, why was that? Because everyone's in close proximity, going here, there, everywhere, shaking hands, hugging on each other, fellowshipping or meeting together or what have you, and it just gives a great opportunity for this uncleanness that was in maybe just one man in the beginning to just spread it about. The Bible principle is this, it's that you need to get rest and that you need to dwell alone. Turn a couple pages over to Leviticus chapter 15. Leviticus chapter 15. Oh, the dreaded Leviticus and all of its uncleanness and issues of blood and leprosy and all those things. It's good teaching. It gives you good principles for life. We see that the Bible revealed in the book of Leviticus, oh man, if the doctors would just realize, if they would have just read it, they would understand, hey, we just need to quarantine this guy when he's sick. We don't need to administer some kind of drug. We just need to get him separate, get him rest, and move on from there. Again, there is always a reason. There is somebody that is sick and unto death that may need a more intrusive help. This is what I'm saying. Basically, if I'm on my deathbed, yeah, if I'm in an accident, if I'm all busted up, give me the morphines, okay? It's a life-threatening issue. There's something very serious going on. And yes, there's the time and the place for that kind of intervention. But typically speaking, when we're sick, we need rest. We need to dwell alone. Look at Leviticus chapter 15 and verse 2. Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when any man hath a running issue out of his flesh, because of his issue he is unclean. And this shall be the uncleanness in his issue, whether his flesh run with his issue, or his flesh be stopped from his issue, it is his uncleanness. There seems to be a possession of that uncleanness. It belongs unto him, and it's contained there. And that's why the resting and the dwelling alone is important. We're looking at the third principle here. Every bed, verse 4, whereon he lieth that hath the issue is unclean. Okay, it is his uncleanness, but now it belongs to the bed. What does it say here? Whereon, and everything whereon he sitteth shall be unclean. And so, therefore, when he comes into proximity with a bed or something that he sitteth upon, that too has become unclean. Verse 5, and whosoever toucheth his bed, well, here it is, the next principle, shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until even. So he is to wash his clothes. He is to bathe himself because he came into proximity with the man that had the issue. That uncleanness belonged to him. Though we see that uncleanness was transferable upon the bed, upon the chair, upon everything that he sitteth, and even this person that approaches unto him. So again, he is told to wash, bathe himself in water, clean his clothes, and be unclean until even. In other words, remain separate, remain in that unclean state until even. So we see that uncleanness passed on to the person. They're to cleanse, and they're to quarantine. They're to stay away from other people. And he that sitteth on anything whereon he sat that hath the issue shall what? Wash his clothes and bathe himself in water. And again, be unclean until the even. And he that toucheth the flesh of him that hath the issue shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until even. And if he that hath the issue spit upon him that is clean, then he shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until even. You're noticing the pattern here. And what saddle soever he rideth upon that hath the issue shall be unclean. Again, something else that he sat upon. And whosoever toucheth anything that was under him shall be unclean until even. And he that beareth any of those things shall wash his clothes, bathe himself in water, and be unclean until even. And whomsoever he touches, and it continues, shall be unclean until even. Verse 13, and when he that hath an issue is cleansed of the issue, then he shall number to himself 7 days for his cleansing. So he's giving himself another window of time. He just got over the sickness, and yet the Bible says number 7 times from when you're starting to be clean of that issue. And what do? He washes his clothes and bathe his flesh in running water and shall be clean. So he's to continue in that quarantine. Everyone that came near him, sat upon the same furniture, was in the proximity, was like, oh, that guy's sick. They're unclean. They go home. They wash their clothes. They wash themselves. They remain separate. The next person, oh, he sat upon that. I sat upon that. I'm going to bathe, wash my clothes, be unclean until even. The same principle applies. When you go out into the world, you're probably going to sit on some places where somebody that was unclean was. You're probably going to touch some things that somebody that was unclean with. You may brush against somebody that has an uncleanness within their flesh. The same principle should apply. You should wash your clothes. You should bathe your flesh and be unclean until even. In other words, once you've got home, you've showered, you just stay home. That's what you do. You're unclean until even. That's the finalizing of your day. And I believe if you do so, and if we follow these principles of sanitation, we'll find that sickness just kind of falls away. It gets much better anyways, and it's much more limited. And the reason why I believe that is because I've seen it practically happen, and also by faith. The Bible says it, so I believe it. We've seen in history the idea of sanitation increasing, and as it does, disease decreases. As men got more capable and more educated and more informed about how important sanitation is, you know, like the Bible described to take the waste without the camp and to bury it, right? The human waste, the defecation, to take it out without the camp and bury it. As culture fell away in the Dark Ages and stopped doing that, we had plagues. We had all sorts of disgusting diseases and carried by rats and carried by people. People died this crazy black death in the Dark Ages because they were not informed about the ideas of sanitation. But as culture came around and started to discover, hey, the Bible's right all along about these things, we started washing our clothes, washing our flesh, being unclean to even when we come around dirty things. We started taking our waste without the camp. Sanitation increases and disease gradually gets worse. gradually gets better, lower and lower and lower. You get less disease happening because of it. The world would look at this and they will say, well, our Savior was the advent of all the medications we've brought on. But you'll see the actual opposite thing if you study it out just a little bit. You'll see that, hey, we were becoming a more sanitary people. Disease was going down. And then suddenly they started introducing these vaccines and these antibodies and all these kinds of things. And we started to see it come up again. Cases are more prevalent. Some diseases that we haven't seen for years are coming back. And it all has to do with the vaccines that are being re-administered. I don't think people are necessarily getting much uncleaner. I think people are still generally washing their hands. Probably too much so in a lot of cases. But we see that there is a direct correlation between sanitation increasing, disease goes down. And then when they administer some of these medications, we start to see that disease starts to return. The Bible's clear. You got to get rest. You got to dwell alone. You got to wash yourself. You got to give yourself space from other people so that the disease doesn't spread about. The solution that the world offers is this. Well, they give you hand sanitizers. They give you chemical wipes and all of these kinds of things. And they've actually had the opposite effect. Instead of just washing yourself with soap and running water, like the Bible says, you mean soap's even a better thing upon what the Bible described, because soap water, essentially what it does is it grabs a hold of the dirt and makes a little bubble around it and helps it remove faster. So that's a great improvement of sanitation that soap made. But regardless, running water seems to be sufficient to cleanse somebody's clothes and flesh and whatever, biblically speaking. But we've taken that to a different step when we've introduced these chemical hand sanitizers. Research on those shows that a lot of them are contributing to the effeminizing of men. There's different chemicals in that as you clean yourself that are encouraging estrogen in them. And we're seeing a lot more girly men walking around, that kind of thing. It's part of the problem. But the other part of the problem is that instead of just, you know, the Bible prescribes just running water. And then we have maybe improved upon that by adding soap. But then we add these chemicals, and they actually encourage adaption and that kind of thing with the germs, whereby your hands are just so clean that you don't personally have any antibodies to it. Like people that just sanitize all the time, you'll see them getting very sick quite often because it's too much, honestly. You need to get a little bit of dirt in you, a little bit of germs and gross or whatever, right? The Bible doesn't say when they touch the unclean person that you're going to wash it right away, like get out of there, get showered. No, it says do it at the end and you're unclean until even, right? It's kind of an end of the day thing. And yet what we do is we'll say, you know, God bless you, nice to meet you. Right? We'll go and we'll try to touch a door to get into something. And then as soon as we get into the building, we're like, right? It's too much. It's way too much. And it promotes these bugs and these germs and these creeping things to actually kind of evolve and adapt and become even stronger. They just have this way of maybe not the diseases themselves, but at least we don't have the antibodies or the little bit of that maybe germ getting in, and our body just fights it off and develops an immunity to it. It becomes this kind of really sanitary environment. And I don't know if you know too much about hospitals, but they're just like full of really bad, really like extremely bad superbugs. And it's because they've created kind of like a super sanitary environment. They've kind of went too far along the scale. Again, they're all like, you know, everyone's hand sanitizing and that kind of thing. So that's the world solution. They've gone too far, I believe, in a lot of ways. The other solution is meds. We take meds when our back hurts. We take meds when we got a headache. We take meds when this hurts, when this spring comes up, when it's too sunny, when it's too dark, when, you know, we just take meds. All the time we're taking medications. I am of the belief that pain is there for a purpose. Pain is there to show you that there's a problem. Again, like I said, if I get out of here and get into a car accident, I'm not gonna be holier than thou and be like, don't give me the morphine. You know what I mean? Like if it's life or death, there is a purpose for some of these really strong drugs. But unfortunately, what we have is an epidemic of people who take these same drugs that are meant for emergencies just because when they wake up in the morning and go to work, their back hurts a little bit, or they're a little bit sore, or they're a little bit this, or a little bit that. And these become something whereby their pain tolerance maybe was here at one point, but then they kind of medicate that, and then their pain tolerance kind of just keeps getting lower. So then they administer the drug, okay, I feel okay. They administer drug, okay, I feel okay. But eventually it kind of reaches this point whereby your pain tolerance just keeps getting lower and lower and lower, and then the slightest thing, and then people start taking more drugs and more drugs and more drugs, and it becomes this addiction. A mental addiction quite often to the drugs, but also a physical addiction. And now you have Now you have people in all shapes of life that are addicted to pharmaceutical drugs, and it's an epidemic. I know so many people who have had maybe just an injury at work, and the doctor's like, okay, take this so your pain goes away. And then they're back to work right away. Again, I probably think they should have done a little bit of rest and dwelling alone when they were hurt, when they were sick. But they're right back into work. I feel great. I feel these drugs are really helping. And they go back to the doctor. They're like, I need a little bit more. I have more of that discomfort. Well, that pain was there to tell you that there was a problem. And when you take the drug and you kind of dilute these nerves and you make them numb, you're injuring yourself further. I noticed that when I was in the whiplash incident. I was given all of these really strong like muscle relaxants. It's kind of a funny story because I came back from it. I was laying on the couch and I took these muscle relaxants, and I don't take drugs or a lot of stuff like that. I didn't even in my past. I was more of a drinker or whatever. But that's not a good thing. But what I'm saying is I just had no concept of this. And my wife came home after I was taking these things. She's like, how are you doing? And I was like, the cat's trying to kill me and take my insurance money. Because I was just like on all of these drugs. I wasn't used to it. And the cat had like, I had whiplash and it had climbed up on top of me. Like, you know, cats like to like purr and like be all under. And I'm trying to get this thing off and I couldn't move. And I was just like, I'm going to die here. Like, it was so upsetting for me with all of the emotions of it all and the pain and everything like that. So I was just like, no, and I threw these things out and I didn't take them. So I spent the next few weeks in a lot of discomfort. Well, I got hit by a transport truck in a car. Of course I was hurt. But through that time, I think my healing got a lot quicker because I knew that, oh, wow, when I do that, that really hurts. Oh, when I do that, okay. So I started to learn what I needed to not do, and I started to rest more. I started to use ice and then heat and then ice. Natural remedies for the same thing. And I came out on the other side not addicted to any kind of drugs for it. And I was healed and I was better, you know. Obviously still some aches and pains or whatever, and I don't take drugs for those either. But some other people have gone through that same story, and we're not talking like crackhead Joe that lives under the bridge. We're talking like doctors, lawyers, bankers, just normal everyday people who have had a similar thing happen to them. Next thing you know, they're on these pills because the physician recommended them. And then they take them, then they take them, then they take them. And next thing you know, they're addicted to them. The doctor cuts them off. They're getting them off the street. And their life is ruined. And they're stuck in this problem that was created by the physician in the first place. So the world says, hey, we just need to be overly sanitary. The world says we need to give you meds if you're in any kind of discomfort at all, right? The world also promotes vaccines. And this is the next thing I really wanted to talk about, I really wanted to focus on. Is that idea of the vaccine, these unclean vaccines. So is the medical world always correct? Well, we've seen a few examples. We know that for a long period of time in the hospitals, they would just rinse in the same basin the blood off, and then they'd go to the next surgery, and then they'd rinse in the same basin, and they'd go to the next surgery. People were getting so sick. And then this scientist discovered germ theory, and he started trying to put this away. And he's telling people, like, look, there's things in this that are unclean, and they are making people sick, and you're transferring from this person to the other person. And everyone's like, this guy is dreaming of things that you can't see, and they threw him in a crazy house. But the Bible basically, principally, preaches the same thing. You need to have space, you need to have running water, you need to have uncleanness. So the medical world wasn't right when they were using stagnant water to clean. The Bible prescribes running water. Bloodletting was very popular. Ask George Washington how that worked out for him. They saw that he was sick, and they started to let out his blood because they figured that, oh, all the bad stuff is within his blood. If we just let it out, he'll get more blood, and then he'll be okay. And they let out his blood until he literally bled out and died. The Bible says that the life, and you can see that over in, he says the life is in the blood. That's Leviticus 17, I believe. You can look that up later. It says that the life is in the blood. So why are we letting out the life trying to save a life? It doesn't even make sense. The life is in the blood, biblically speaking. So again, the medical world was incorrect. This living, vibrant blood then What we do now is we take that life that's in the blood, and we've advanced so much further than George Washington is. We're not letting out the life that's in the blood. But what we do then is we take death and we shoot it directly into the blood. And then we do that as part of health. So when you see kind of this medical track record of just making really crazy decisions that are anti-biblical, then why would you then look at something like the life-giving blood having a chemical slurry put into it and think, oh, that's going to help, that's going to protect, that's going to give me the help that I need in order that I won't get sick? Now, these chemicals that they put into these vaccinations and put them into your living blood, your life, which is in that blood, there are chemicals you couldn't even frame to pronounce them. I know we all have troubles when we go through the book of Numbers and we're reading names of people, and that's really hard. But there are names like 15 times longer than that, just these crazy chemical compounds that you don't even know what that is. But then the ones you do understand, it's just like aluminum dimethyl this and beta something or other and all these things. And the more you look into it, you're like, they're culturing these things from dead organisms. They're taking heavy metals and dropping them into them as preservatives. They're unclean by every definition of the word. I mean, you would look at something like this and read the instructions, you're like, I would never eat that. But then we take those same things, we just put them directly into our blood. It doesn't make sense, given the biblical principle that the life is in the blood. These unclean beasts and these creeping things, that's the theory that a lot have about the vaccinations, is, oh, we give you a little bit of the living virus, the living creeping thing, and then when you put it in your bloodstream, you're going to develop this antibody. It doesn't even make sense, but then a lot of them are confused about it because they'll say, oh, those bugs aren't even alive anyway, so then you're putting a dead thing into you. I don't know what's worse, a dead bug or a live bug. They're all unclean creeping things, and if you were to read through Leviticus, you see these great lists of animals that you're not to eat because they're unclean, creeping things being one of them. You're supposed to wash your clothes if you come near them. If you come near a carcass of one of them, you're supposed to wash your clothes and be separate from them. You're not supposed to eat them. You're not supposed to touch them. And yet we take these same unclean creeping things and unclean beasts, we culture up a chemical slurry of disgustingness, and then we shoot it into our bodies. We inject it into ourselves. God said, don't touch it. Why would we then think that we can take this in and just put it into us? It doesn't even make sense. It's unclean. The biggest thing that I find, my biggest problem with the whole vaccination movement right now, is that they're trying to remove my personal choice from it. Look, I reject smoking cigarettes. I think it's stupid. I think it's dumb. I think it's a waste of money. I think it's a waste of time. It doesn't even make sense. But I'm not going to encourage some sort of legislature that says nobody is allowed to smoke anymore. I think alcohol is wicked. It's disgusting. It'll ruin your life. It destroys families. It's for unwise and wicked people to feast upon in order to make themselves seem like they're not so unwise or wicked, right? That's what alcohol did to me in my experience as well, as I drank it when I was at a younger age. I think it's disgusting, but again, I would not enforce or encourage any kind of legislation that said you can't do it. We all have the choice to be wise or unwise, and I believe that is biblical. But now they are taking this same kind of mentality that says, well, you should have to take this vaccine. They've got this crazy mindset that if I'm not vaccinated and everyone else is, they're all at risk because I'm not vaccinated. So therefore, they're going to tell me that I must do what they want me to do with my own body. No, this is mine. This belongs to God. This was made by God. You shouldn't have any right to what I want to do with it. You shouldn't have any right to touch it. Infringe upon my God-given liberty to do what I want with the vessel that He gave to me. But that's the vaccination mindset. These same people that'll use the my body, my choice to justify abortions in women. When I say my body, my choice, they say, uh-uh, because your body's affecting me. They just use whatever kind of moving of the goalposts they can in order to push this. And this is my main problem, is that they are trying to push for no choice. Now, if you want to shoot up this junk, if you want to get informed about what's in there, a lot of people don't. Again, they just take the advice of their physician and just do it. But if you want to make that decision, I'm not going to stop you. I may try to help you and teach you a few things, but if you say, no, I've heard what you have to say, I'm getting my flu shot, hey, that's fine with me. Don't bother me one bit. Go ahead. Have at it. It's your free will choice to make. But don't tell me that I have to take it and give me none of that right to make my own decision about the thing. My problem is that they are trying to remove the choice. Where God promotes knowledge and wisdom and understanding and people getting a grasp and a mind of what they are taking into their body, making decisions about what they eat, about what they drink, about what they do. God promotes that kind of knowledge and wisdom. Men try to silence it. Now you have like Facebook, and I bet you YouTube's on the heels. You have all of the mainstream media promoting vaccines and saying that, hey, we think that you shouldn't have a choice. And if anyone tries to give the opposing position, they are now, especially Facebook, trying to just shut it down. Stop it. That same thing that I said where somebody is like, you know, the lost person's like, vaccinate your blanking kids, and they're like, we did. I suspect that whole motivation, that whole education program that's out there where people are saying, I did vaccinate, I did what you said, and now my child is dead, hurt, injured. They're trying to silence that. And again, I don't believe that in that either. I believe that if I have the truth and you are contrary to me, I can give you the truth and speak the truth to you, and the truth should be able to speak for itself. Why would you have to silence the opposition unless you know that the truth is threatening it? Right. You know that what people are trying to put at you is the truth. People are giving real testimonies of what had happened. People are giving real lists of the diseases and the disgustingness of these vaccines, educating people, and the only response from the liars is to simply close off the opposing view. I don't agree with that. I believe everybody should be able to communicate, educate, discuss, learn all types of ideas and all types of thinking ways and all types of promotion of whatever they believe. That should be free. And so God promotes knowledge, God promotes wisdom, and men try to silence all opposition. It ain't right. My other problem is that God gives us free will and God gives us choices in life, and men are now trying to deny that. God in Genesis chapter 3 put the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in a very good garden, and he said, don't eat it lest you die. Okay? He gave the command that ye shall die if you take this, but then he said choose. He put it there and said choose. Choose to obey me or choose not to obey me. The time of Joshua, Joshua cried out to the people of Israel. He says, choose this day whom you will serve. The gods that you serve on the other side of the flood, or the Lord God. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He proclaimed the truth and let men decide, let men choose for themselves. And that's God's way. God chooses to set before men life and death, and then he says, choose life. That's how God works. He doesn't blind the world to the ways of the world and the ways of Satan in order that their only choice is to serve him. Oh, God looks great. No, God allows for the world to coexist with the people of God, and so that men can choose whether they're going to follow the way, the truth, the life, or whether they're going to follow the ways and the gods of this world. We're always given a choice, and yet men are trying to cut that off. And I disagree with that. I think that's wicked. God says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And this liberty should allow all men to be educated, to choose what they will do with their own body. And I believe that we should have that same liberty in the land that we live in, to choose whether or not we have this stuff put into our bodies, to choose whether or not we take the medication, to choose whether or not, rather, we just wash our hands, stay home, and do things the biblical way. We should all be in the realm of free will, where we can choose one way or another. We can choose life, we can choose death. We have the opportunity to choose, and that's how what God promotes. Turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 16. I think obviously Christians should choose God's way of doing things. We should choose to have rest when we're sick, to dwell alone, to wash, to bathe, to be informed about the kind of medications, make choices for our children, make choices for how they're raised, how their medical process goes through, and that sort of thing. But first thing I believe that Christians should do is choose to trust the Lord first. Again, Jesus said, they that are sick have need of the physician, not they that are whole. So there's a time and place for the physician. 2 Chronicles chapter 16 and in verse 11 says, and behold the acts of Asa, first to last, lo, they are written in the book of the kings of Judah and Israel. And Asa in the 39th year of his reign was diseased in his feet. until his disease was exceeding great. Yet in his disease he sought not to the Lord, but to the physicians. And Asa slept with his fathers. So he made the decision to seek first unto the physicians and not to even seek God. So I believe that in our realm of living, in our realm of when we are sick, we ought to seek first unto God. How do we seek first unto God? Well, we pray unto him and just ask for specific needs about the diseases that we have. We also just go to the scriptures and see these principles. Hey, I'm sick, so God wants me to rest. He wants me to dwell alone. He wants me to wash and bathe if I've touched any unclean thing. And in doing so, we're doing the opposite of what Asa did. We're not just running to the physicians every time you have some disease. It didn't end so well for Asa. Maybe he'd have a different story had he sought unto the Lord instead of these things. So that's just a piece of advice for each and every one of us, is that when you start to come down with something, look specifically to James chapter 4, I believe, or maybe 5. The Bible talks about how if any of you are sick, let him call for the elders of the church, be anointed with oil, and prayed for. That was the prescription given within the church, was there was anointing of oil. But it came from, it was initiated by the person that was sick. And that's what I always notice is kind of funny, because if you go to like those Pentecostal meetings and the Benny Hinn swinging his jacket, he's always calling for the sick. Sick people, come on and I'll heal you. I'm going to swing my jacket at you. You're all going to fall over and be healed. So, no, the Bible prescribes that the sick comes to the church and they ask, could you anoint me with oil? Could you pray for me? And I believe that's the first step of anyone that is sick is yes, to seek the Lord. And if there's something that is ailing them and it's going to be a disease that's really going to hurt them and affect them, hey, if you feel led of the Lord, come to the church. Ask that they anoint you with oil and pray for you. John chapter 11 talks about Lazarus when he died, okay? And so his sister Mary and Martha asked for Jesus to come. So again, the Christians, the believers, sought the Lord in prayer for the person that was sick. When Jesus showed up, Martha or Mary, I can't remember which one, said to him, you know, if in that time he had died. And she said, if you had been here, Lord, if you had answered our prayer, if you had shown up on time, he would not have died. And the response was this, I am the resurrection of the life. And he said, believest thou this? And when that exchange happened, she said to him, yes, Lord, I know he will raise again in the resurrection. Okay, so her faith was such that she believed the Bible, and the Bible said that 100 years, 200 years, how many years from now, he is going to rise again. But she did not have the faith to believe that Jesus Christ, who was standing right there, was able to make him rise only after 4 days. You see how there was a very big faith. She knew, of course he's dead and he's going to heaven. Of course he's going to raise again at the last day. That might be 100, 200, 1,000 years from now, but I believe God will do this really big thing. And yet she did not believe in this moment in response to the question that Jesus posed. And you can read that again in John chapter 11. She didn't believe that he could raise him after four days of being dead. Yeah, if he's dead for 1,000 years, you'll raise him at the resurrection. But she needed to have the faith to believe, hey, just 4 days. And that's what exactly what Christ did. He raised her again. And it happened in the same pattern and in the same manner, whereby they sought the Lord before the physicians. The Lord gave the prescription, which at this time, maybe it was to rest, to dwell, and to wash, or whatever. But they had the faith to come to the church. The believers had the faith to reach out to God in prayer. The person had the faith to go and ask to be healed, to ask to be helped. And it was all on the heels of going to God first. Again, I'm not a physician, but Jesus Christ is the great physician. And there are principles here that we can learn from in regard to our health. So we're not always running to the physician, who I believe is malicious at best anymore. All they're going to do is try to give you the drug. They're trying to give you the pill. They're trying to give you the needle. They're trying to give you some crazy quick fix that has nothing to do with actually helping you. There's more risk of harm coming because of it. And it's just a sad state that we live in. And what's even sadder is that they're trying to make so that I don't even have a choice of what to do with my own children in these areas. I don't even have a choice of what to do with my own health in these areas. So Christians, we need to educate ourselves. We need to make wise decisions when it comes to our health. Hey, quarantine yourself, wash your clothes, do all the right things that the Bible prescribes. Stay away from people. Stay home when you're not feeling well. We also need to understand that these things need to be made aware. We need to do something to fight for the rights that we do have here at this moment. Educate others. Preach the gospel. Get people saved. Do whatever we can to kind of motivate this at least current little bit of freedom that we do have at this time. And it's going to start from, first of all, seeking God when you're sick. First of all, seeking God when you need help. First of all, seeking God in all areas of our life and understanding that, hey, the physician always doesn't have the cure, but the great physician has cures for all things. And these are just a few thoughts, a few ideas about the unclean vaccine. Again, I'm not up here just trying to like say that, oh, you shouldn't do this, shouldn't do that. You got to make your own decisions, but I believe it's our God-given right to make those decisions. And if you want to continue to have the liberty to make those decisions, hey, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek and turn from their evil way, then will I hear from heaven and will hear their land. It starts honestly with us. We need to seek God. We need to ask God to not have these freedoms taken from us. We need to ask God to not have the police showing up at our door, reaching or ripping our children out of us because we made such and such a decision about their health. We need to ask God to answer our prayers and to help us in these areas as we have now and hope that He would give us sustaining power on the freedoms that we do have or that we continue to live the life that we're living. But it starts with us. It starts with us being unclean in our mind, clean in our minds and our thoughts, in our actions, so that He can answer our prayers, heal our land, and help us to continue. I mean, in the States, it is getting ugly, this whole vaccine thing. And for now, they're not kicking down our doors in Canada, but there is a big push. There is big pressure being put on people to mandate these. We need to educate ourselves, and we need to know where we stand before. And we have to stand here, what the Bible says, and just trust God. Heavenly Father.